Today in Maker Faire, we see people hacking electronics. We see people hacking structures. But we are on the verge of hacking the other things, which is biologies. Today we're going to have four people from all over the world talking about their DIY bio labs. And then we are going to have a discussion how we can start this in Shenzhen. So for the first speaker would be Tito from Bio-Curious in San Francisco.
Bio-Curious. A hackerspace for biotech. We started 4 years ago near San Francisco, California. The idea was we wanted to make biotechnology more accessible to everyone in the area. Nothing like this ever existed before. The reason we did this was we were interested in starting biotech experiments and learning about what is it to play with biotechnology. It was really expensive. Renting lab space was $10,000 a month, and I don't have that much money. That's a lot of money. That's like a car every month. And the context was we wanted to make that cheap, so we started a Bio-Curious as a basically a gym membership for biotechnology. So it's $100 a month, like 600 yuan. So pretty cheap to come and use a couple million dollars worth of lab equipment. So is Bio-Curious successful? It's been 4 years. That's a really good question. So do we have startups? Do we have new ideas and new innovations coming from Bio-Curious? Is Bio-Curious an idea that's being heard around the world? I just want to show you a couple examples of things that are happening at Bio-Curious. So this is one of the projects that started there. It's a genetic engineering project. It's making a little bush that glows in the dark using DNA from a firefly. And so that probably sounds really wacky, and it is. And that's what's really wonderful about the world of biotechnology is people can come and do this stuff. They launched on Kickstarter, and they sold about $500,000 of seeds to people all around the world. This is a 3D printer for biology. So a lot of you are familiar with 3D printers. It prints plastic. This is actually printing cells. So to be able to print living things. They're working on printing a leaf, printing ears maybe in the future, or a new nose, or maybe a new heart. And that's what it looks like. It's an open source hardware project. It's basically built by a bunch of people that are just getting together every Thursday night and working on it. And then this is real vegan cheese. So they're making cheese using yeast. So you would make beer using yeast, and they're taking the DNA from a cow and they're putting it into yeast, and somehow that's going to create this milk and create this cheese. And so is Bio-Curious successful? Is this, I mean, this is, there's these startups, there's these inventions that are being used around the world. I've been able to visit places like Bio-Curious all around the globe. So yes, Bio-Curious is a success after 4 years. But that's not what I'm here to talk about today. What I'm here to talk about today is when we started Bio-Curious, it was about making biotechnology more accessible. But what emerged is this new way to create, this new way to invent, and this new way to collaborate. And it's purely through passion and motivation and this need to be curious. And so it's just people getting together. We had this group come in, and they're working on a project called the Open Source Microscope Project. So their goal is to make a really awesome microscope, and they meet once a week every Wednesday night. And I remember coming into the lab and hearing people introduce themselves, and this one guy walks in, and he sits down, and he's the first person to speak up, and he says, "I drove 2 hours to be here." That's crazy. So he drove from Vallejo, which is 2 hours away, to come to this open source microscope project. And then next to him is a woman, and she's like, I work at Google, and I sort of snuck out of work early so that I could come work on this microscope project. And neither of them have a biology background at all. And then next to them is Maria, and she used to do marketing at Apple. And she's also working on this microscope. And then there's Eric, and Eric works for BGI, which is, he's a real scientist. He just got back, actually, from Shenzhen. He was on complete opposite time zone. And so this, why are these people here? What are they doing at Bio-Curious? And what they're doing is they're discovering together. They're learning together. They're creating this stuff out of their own passion and their motivation and their curiosity. And I think that's what the success of Bio-Curious is about. So I'm hoping we can talk a lot about that today. I've got a couple ideas, I think, of how maybe you can add more creativity to your own work, the things I've learned from Bio-Curious. Basically, if you can do more public projects, so bring people in your building into your project, or bring people in your area into your project. Places, if you can change the place that you work, maybe go and work. Try programming out in the heat one day and just see what it's like, or try going to a hackerspace and seeing how that changes your perspective. And so change the people and change the place that you work, and create these public projects. And I think that's a really good way to be more Bio-Curious with your own work. So we have kids come for classes, we have adults work on projects like this, and it's purely out of passion and motivation and curiosity. We were over at Maker Week. Did anybody stop by the Maker Week booth to see Bio-Curious? Cool. All right, everybody in the front row, big fans. And so we were doing a DNA extraction experiment there that I wanted to show you. And so I think the next step is I'm interested in starting maybe a version of Bio-Curious in Shenzhen. What would that look like? I don't know. But I'm interested in also talking about that. So thank you very much. My name is Tito Jankowski. I'm one of the co-founders of Bio-Curious, and I'm from San Francisco, California.
Next up, we have Lucas, all the way from Netherlands, and going to talk about his biospace.
Thank you, Shenzhen Maker Week, and thank you, Municipality of Shenzhen, Maker Movement, for inviting me. My name is Lucas Evers. I'm from Waag Society in Amsterdam. I'm briefly going to say something about what we do. I didn't expect so quick to be on stage, so. All right, this is how it works. This is our space. Looks very clean. It's a mess now because we just finished the Biohack Academy. And we are a physical lab, but we are not just only a laboratory. We also do workshops, we do exhibitions, we do performances, we do we have the lab, and we have a lot of different approaches to what we do in that lab. So we have an open design approach, is that, uses as designers, critical making, that was named earlier, and something we call probes for debate. So making together with a variety of people, engineers, artists, engineers, scientists, and the public. We make GMOs, we make in vitro meat, etc., in order to also have a discussion about where that should go, that sort of a design. Here's our setup. We copied it from an article in Nature by Rob Carlson, and it's fairly simple. Check it, because this is how you can make your own lab. You got a PCR, a freezer, an incubator, an autoclave, which is just a nice rice pan, a high-pressure rice pan, etc. But what more? We bring many disciplines together, and that is also something I would like to leave here, that it's good to have makers collaborate with designers, with citizens, with artists, with policymakers, with engineers, with scientists. We are housed in this old building. The Waag used to be a city gate, and in that building we have this. This is an old anatomical theater where they, in the 17th century, 16th century even, dissected hung criminals. So it is a very emblematic space where you find the cradle of medical technology and medical science in the Netherlands. This is a famous painting by a famous Dutch painter, Rembrandt van Rijn, who depicted that practice in there. The famous painting, the anatomy of Dr. Tulp. Waag Society wants to make also technology accessible to the people. We started off 20 years ago with something called the digital city. There was internet, but there were no websites yet in mainland Europe. We made one, which was analog to the physical city, and everybody could get 2 megabytes, that was a lot of web space, and a free email address. And it meant a lot for the spread of the internet in the Netherlands. I think even we had the highest internet penetration for long in the Netherlands. I love this to become Shenzhen. We make a, I got it in my pocket, we make a smartphone, which is this one. It's made here probably, but what we do with it is have contracts with mines in Congo. Every piece of electronic communication equipment contains minerals, often cobalt and coltan, coming from conflict zones like Congo. Now, this is not the fairest phone you can imagine. This is a little bit fairer. We work with mines that have a contract that says not militarized, no child labor, and minimum wages. That's much better than all the other mines that produce coltan that is in a lot of our stuff. So that's a bit the structure of all the other labs we have. And coming back to this physical lab of the Open Wetlab, where we bring art, science, design, engineering in biology and bioengineering together. We recently finished the Biohack Academy, which is something that is close to the Fab Academy. It's not as long. It's 10 weeks how to build your own bio lab. So everybody who was at the Civic Center saw a number of the results of our students that were buying spectrometers, centrifuges, peristaltic pumps. We even built our own PCR. I had the PCR that was made by Tito. I had that in my exhibition because it's such a great emblematic piece of equipment that meant a lot. So this is what you do in 10 weeks, but besides making all the equipment yourself, you also learn how to culture your own microorganisms, algae, bacteria, etc., etc. We even do tissue culturing. You learn how to work safe. You learn how to make your own media to grow things on. And you end up with a self-assignment, which is making a work. Here you see one of our students, Tony Garcia, who was an American pensioner living in Amsterdam. He was a journalist. He was busy with life prolongment of a lab worm, C. elegans. Here, some bioprinting by a number of Italian designers. Eline van der Ploeg, who worked with making fonts for graphic design out of living materials. We didn't only have 15 students in Amsterdam that worked those 10 weeks through. We had a number of partner labs in Rome. This is a picture in Rome. We had a partner lab in Brazil, in a number of other places. I don't know whether I had that slide in another presentation. Here you see how the people were working in the lab in Amsterdam, and here you see how they make a DIY microscope, a magnetic stirrer, and here you see, well, that is one of the, sorry, I go back briefly. Can I go back? Yeah. This is one of the funny projects. They made a racetrack for slime molds in order to make slime molds race against each other. For that, they built a very big bioreactor in order to have good temperature and moisture, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody got a reward after the thing. Everything is on GitHub. So if you want to start it here, take a picture. But you can also do it together with us. So we're happy if you contact us for more information, if you want that. Something about the Open Wet Lab in its context. As I said, we are not only a hack lab. We are also a lab that works in a context with scientists, artists, other sorts of makers than just makers that make objects or products or innovations. Here, this is a work of Adam Zaretsky and Oren Katz, who have been making in vitro meat, which later, and I'm going to skip the next slide for time reasons, who later came back to do that again at this anatomical theater. And together with other artists, we made a dinner called The Other Dinner, where we have been making the animals that are the best animals to make in vitro meat of, to understand the meat of the future and meat consumption of the future. So we had a dinner that was cooked by all the people that came, and the last course was also making the in vitro meat. So taking a living cell culture, putting it in a feeding medium, and see that there is cell division. So in fact, you see that there is growing meat. This is a work we did with Richard Powell. He had a collection of post-natural organisms exhibited in our space. Post-natural organisms, to his in his thought, are all the organisms that genetically and hereditarily are altered by human hands. Trust Me, I'm an Artist is a project where we invite artists to come up with artistic concepts or artistic works that deal with the ethical ambiguities and complexities of working in life science, in biosciences. You always work with life if you have such a lab, so you always have to consider what you do with that life. One of the projects we work with got also rewarded the Ars Electronica Prize was an artist couple from Paris, art object-oriented, who developed an artwork over 10 years where the female artist of the couple was receiving horse blood, half a liter, for which he got a blood therapy that they self-designed and published about its autoimmune reactions found in it. She wanted to commend the far-going industrialization of our ecology, which is also a part of something that we want to bring to an audience, to think about what you do if you set up a biolab. This is, I see a very different picture there on the screen. But we also organized something called the Bio Art and Design Award. People can hand in a very simple idea. They are matched with a research group. If there is a match that the research group says, okay, let's develop that further, there is a collaboration in the development of the second iteration of that project that is put in front of a jury that is made up of arts experts or artists and people from science. If you get rewarded, we reward three a year. They get 25,000 euros and access to a lab. Here you see a work of Charlotte Jarvis, who made a stem cell sculpture of her own body, donating blood, bladder cells, and you see her skin cells taken there. Another project is that of Howard Boland, who worked with magnetic bacteria, of which he made a camera. These are the winners of this year. So the winners were announced just about a month ago. Um, How much time do I have? 2 minutes? I don't know whether I'm boring you meanwhile. But here you see something of all the little workshops we organized, making meat, making paint of bacteria and so forth, brain hacking, working with algae for food. Here again, you have the open dinner, so I was a bit confused about the order. There's a few more projects. There's two more. Did I shock you? Go to our website, you'll find the protocol and you can do it yourself. If you do it clean, there's no risk of getting harmed. This is the last course where we were really culturing meat with our audience. That is my colleague Peter van Bohemen. We also have a weekly open day. And there's a lot of people coming to us, often like with Bio-Curious, that have no direct background in biotech whatsoever. There's a lot of designers, there's a lot of artists coming. This is work of Ingrid Nijhoff, who had a question about the toxicity of paint production. It's often quite toxic, and she had, it may be a naive question, but she started making paints produced by bacteria, by culturing the bacteria you can find in flower pots in your home, between your toes, etc. She got the Dutch Material Design Award for that. Another work is of an artist, Nina van der Broek, who had a question about ivory and the poaching of elephants for ivory production. She thought, well, can't you make that in vitro, ivory? That appeared to be very difficult, but she found that she could do something else, and it was make rhinoceros horn in vitro, because that's very close as a material to what our skin is made of. Skipping through these, because I see, is Thomas here? Yeah. One last project I want to say something about is BioStrike. It goes up and down now. BioStrike was a project that was an idea of my colleague Peter van Bohemen and Denise Kera, who is an associate professor at Singapore University, to make a citizen science platform that is giving attention by hands-on involving those citizens to depletion of antibiotics. You can involve citizen science to do so, and that makes them also understand what is at stake there. We did a number of workshops throughout Europe, meanwhile, and I think in Singapore they even made a social game out of it. You see a picture here of. So I've told you with all these projects a little bit about the variety of activities we do in the Open Wet Lab. What I want to make a plea for here, during the week I was here, I had a lot of fantastic conversations with people that were highly interested. But if you want to bring such a thing to a next level, I'm missing a lot of artists and a lot of designers that critically question the technology you use here in order to make a thoughtful and critical base on which you build a lot of innovation and maker's culture. I hope I've shown a few projects that address that sort of thing, that is also addressed in our Biohack Academy, which is approximately my last slide, for which I want to tell you all, if you are interested to join us, we start our next edition September 15th. I believe there are still two more places, and if you want to be a partner lab, that is also still possible. The next one is in the spring. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Lucas. So next up, even though we don't have a biohacking space in Shenzhen yet, but we do have a great biotech company in Shenzhen. Next up, we welcome Yingrui from BGI.
So today I would like to talk a little bit about my thoughts on the decolonized life sciences. And I'm from BGI, and it was Beijing Genomics Institute, and apparently it's not, it's no longer Beijing Genomics Institute, it's just BGI, and we are located in the east part of Shenzhen, the Yantian Harbor, if you know it. And we are located in a shoe factory, which was the biggest shoe factory in the Asia Pacific region. And thanks to the financial crisis in 2008, and the shoe factory goes bankruptcy, and we move in. So what are we doing there? So this is a little bit trying to encourage us to think about what life is. And this is one of the metal name card that's the Pioneer 10 and Pioneer 11 bring to the outer space in the universe. A lot of the information on the card is actually are something that is actually digital. So they use a lot of information to try to characterize the hydrogen atoms and also the relative distance of our solar system. But interesting enough, when they're trying to talk about human, talking about life, they use analog shapes instead of some digital information to describe life. And if one day there is a alien who really finds this credit card and they're trying to go back to the Earth and trying to find something looks like this, it's very likely that they will not find us. Because think about that. Millions of years ago, what do we really look like? And millions of years after, what do we really look like? So analog information or the analog shapes cannot be representative for human or for all the forms of life. So I think basically the life is actually a digital and quantifiable, and it can be described in a lot of levels by really informations instead of just the analog shapes. So we think that life can be really described on different layers. One is a DNA by nature. It's a four-letter coded, and the data and program are all coded in the DNA. And we do have a lot of intermediates on those RNA, small molecules, proteins, that, as you all know, they are the dynamic life status. And from the accessibles, that is the urine, saliva, all the things that you could think about, then you can actually mirror them. And also we have the phenotypes, that is viable traits. When you go to hospital, they imaging you. And we have a social life. And we all know that we have all those so-called mobile internet plus whatsoever, all this tech information. And we are also exposed to the lighter environment. We have air, water, soil, et cetera. So basically, we are able to use very accurate information system trying to describe all the aspects of life. And the goal is actually very easy. We're trying to reverse engineering the code of life, and we're trying to manipulate so that we can improve all the aspects of life, and we can improve biotechnologies. So if the life is considered as a digital system, well, we could think about that, how can we really study life sciences in a more generalized way under some paradigm. So one thing is we should have the data acquisition systems. We should have the computing system to process all the data. We should have data space to store all the data, information, and knowledge. And we should build a lot of applications upon this type of system. So in the nowadays, actually, life science is not is no longer just biology. It's actually an interdisciplinary field that attracts a lot of different domains to decipher the arts of life. So one thing is, again, as I mentioned earlier, the mobile internet platforms, they use devices and applications trying to track social life data. And we have the omics medical centers trying to acquire those DNA information, those intermediate information, as well as those medical phenotyping information. And we also have the new IT platform and infrastructures trying to help all this biological big data, and we have the sort of like an app store in the life sciences and biotech working for basic research, human healthcare, and a green industry. So by nature, the goal is to give in the multiple globally quantifiable levels of life, and by the right organization and coordination with worldwide collaborators, we would like to establish the basis for reduce birth defect and prolong lifespan expectation and contribute to food production by the year of 2019. And this is how the BGI actually designed, right? The BGI, we have the computer genomics working here. We have BGI Online, which is hosting a sort of a cloud computing system, if it's easier for you. Sort of a cloud computing system trying to host different of the analytical workflows, pipelines, tools, whatever. And we have the multiple omics database and national gene bank to host all the samples, all the biopsies, and all the data that generated from all the forms of life. And we build a lot of the applications based on this infrastructure. So we do have a lot of our branches, like BGI Research Institute, college, and we have BGI company that work for the clinical diagnostics, and we have BGI Agriculture. This is by design where looks at this. And we also have some subsidiaries work and collaborators working on the IT part, and we have sequencing centers, joint labs working on the biodata part, and we have mobile internet platform here working here. So all these parts are actually now widely open for potential collaborators and joint ventures in different type of forms. And we are all working together trying to contribute to the decolonized life sciences and trying to really understand how life works and trying to improve the all the forms of life. So that's what we define the BGI. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. So next up, before we start in the panel, Thomas, you finally make it. So Thomas from France.
Okay. So you already had many introduction to biohacking. So I'm afraid I'm going to do a small other one. So excuse me if I repeat what others have already said. So I'm going obviously to talk about biohacking and DIY bio. So my name is Thomas Landrain, and I come from Paris in France, and I'm the co-founder and president of La Paillasse, which is the first biohacker space in France. So to talk about biohacking, I usually start with a little story, and that story starts 70 years ago with invention, you know, with a discovery of the structure of DNA. 70 years ago, we discovered, you know, what was the support of life, and that changed everything because we came from an era of observation to an era of modification, of making, you know. So that time, biology became a technology, you know, and in 70 years, biology has made huge progress at a very fast pace. And just to give you an example, so you're already familiar probably with this, as you have one of the leader here in Shenzhen with BGI, is genome sequencing. So there is a hidden revolution behind the one of the digital revolution. It is a biotech revolution. We have access to tools that are much faster, much simpler, much, you know, less expensive than other ones to sequence genetic information, to have access to the support of life information. And the pace at which it's going is incredibly fast. And basically, we came from this. That was a room full of sequencers. And it would take months, if not years sometimes, to do projects around human genomes, to this in 15 years only. And we came now to sequence a human genome is about $1,000. It takes even sometimes a few hours if you're really good at it. So it's not only about tech revolution. It's not only a technological revolution. It's also a social revolution, because when you get things smaller, simpler, cheaper, well, it means that you have a much larger diversity of people that can access the tool and express themselves with it. It's exactly what happened in the 70s. I don't know if you remember, but in the 70s, computers were a very large machine, you know, very expensive, with very narrow use, you know, only used in very big corporations. But at the same time, in big universities, you could actually learn how to make computers. It was taught to the students there. And at the same time, also, the price of the component, electrical components, were decreasing very fast. So that enabled students to go together in garages and make their own computers. And they didn't make their own computers, you know, for the current model at the time. They made computers for themselves, for their own use. And that's what changed everything, because then they could express a new potential, a new vision of the tool itself. And that was the beginning of the digital revolution, because there was a huge democratization of the computers. And if in the 20th century, you know, we were hacking computers, in the 21st, we're hacking biology. So that global movement is called DIY Bio. It's all about reappropriation. You want to express different things using biology, not usually what current labs are doing, but the way you see things. And that's exactly what makes DIY Bio interesting, because you can imagine new frontiers for biology, and not frontiers that are defined by, let's say, academics or experts, but defined by yourself. So you have pure freedom. Just to give you a short impression about why DIY bio and biohacking could be also a movement for the future of science in general. This is the evolution of the average age in the US to get, let's say, a grant to make you an independent researcher. So time at which you're finally going to be, you know, doing what you want. In the 80s, you could wait around 30, 35 years old, which is fine. But as time goes by, you see the average age actually is getting more around 50 years old. And that is not right. It's not right because it means that we have a huge new generation waiting actually to express themselves, but they don't get the opportunity to do it. So it's even shocking when you know that Einstein and Darwin, two very famous scientists, they made their main discoveries before the age of 30. So Darwin, for example, was on the Beagle, the boat that went to the Pacific Ocean to meet the Galapagos and imagine the theory of evolution. He was 21. So we had actually, our institutions somehow sometimes lack the ability to bring actually new minds and new ideas to their cycles, and we miss actually some part of this creativity. So there is a huge frustration, for example, at least, you know, in Europe for that. So La Paillasse was an experiment conducted actually to try to answer this frustration, to make a lab outside a university setting, outside an academic setting, and see, you know, what could become when of a lab when you completely open it. And when you're very young and you don't have any resources, well, you try to build something, you know, well, in the places that somehow are affordable to you. So we made the first biohacking space of France in a squat. This was in the suburb of Paris and in Vitry-sur-Seine. And in the squat where it was full of artists, and we took about 30 square meters there, and we made a completely equipped lab. It took us about 3 months to gather all the lab equipment we needed to make a completely functional lab, a biotech lab. imagine this lab was even more functional than the one I was in when I was doing my PhD, and it was completely free. That was a shock for me. So when we did that, we invited everybody to come in. And what was the surprise is, it's not biologists that came first. It's non-biologists. People that always wanted to do biology, but never could. Because biology somehow belongs to the ivory tower. If you want to access a biotech lab, well, you have to be somehow a biologist. But that is wrong. Wrong, especially today, where everybody can access a computer, so why not access a pipette, you know? So we tried to change that. So we had then a huge community of engineers, designers, artists, scientists to work together. We were doing, you know, workshops to learn each other's skills. We are doing analysis outside. We organize workshops and we work on lab equipment to make cheap alternative to current equipment. So you probably had a few examples, especially with Tito, I guess, with OpenPCR. So we had a magnific garden where we could debate with each other. So that was an experiment. But then, you know, what kind of project do you do in that kind of space? So we of course experimented around stuff like the OpenPCR, the project Tito, because it was one of the very first piece of lab equipment that you could, you know, work around. It was so important, the PCR. This is another project that started more recently. It's an open ultrasound machine. You probably know about the ultrasound machine because it's a very important tool for medicine and diagnosis. But it's very expensive. So we have a group of people thinking and working on a new concept. It's an ultrasound probe that you could plug on a smartphone that could cost less than 500 euros. Ultrasound machine usually costs at least 30,000 euros. It's huge. So that's something very powerful. We also work on biomaterials. And to give you an example, we had 2 years ago the first of its kind project to think about. Imagine a pen. You write with pen, right? You write with inks. But imagine a pen that could produce its own ink. So instead of having a cartridge, you have a bioreactor inside with bacteria producing pigments, and you write with the pigments produced by the bacteria. And in exchange, you have to feed the bacteria. So at the end, it's like you have to feed your own pen for it to write. So we thought the idea was cool. So we started to work on it, and we came over with a proof of concept. It was the first ink to be produced by bacteria. That was a huge hit. And imagine, you could grow your own ink at home, especially knowing that ink is quite a toxic product. So here, you don't have actually to think anymore about recycling your own ink because it's biodegradable. And so we could make several colors, for example, and work with it. What's interesting is that project now is also a startup and has made a partnership with BIC. So it's a very famous pen manufacturer. So who knows, maybe we'll have soon BIC with bio ink inside. Another thing, when you think about biomaterials, there is so many interesting things to do with it. Materials that you can bioproduce locally if you want, and that are biodegradable. What an amazing alternative to current materials that are fuel derivatives. So if you want to express the potential of bioproduction, the potential of life to transform matter, then you need a special tool. You need a bioreactor. Bioreactor are very expensive. They are the machines that enables you to control the microorganisms. So we decided to make a project in La Paillasse to make a bioreactor that would be extremely cheap and open source, to enable almost anybody to work with it, to work with bioproduction. And in fact, we also got some money from NASA through a foundation called Space Gambit. We called for NASA, and Space Gambit said, guys, if you want to go to space, you better actually manage better your waste, because, you know, nowadays when you're going to a space station, you have to bring back your waste by a rocket. And that's very expensive. Why not thinking about circulating all the elements in the same place? You know, exactly as life is doing on Earth. A waste is not a waste, it's only a transformative matter. It's food for something else. So we did that first bioreactor. And now there is a huge movement around it. If you you find actually many interesting applications around that, and I encourage you actually to look for one. So another project I'd like to present you, it's a new project we've done recently. It's called the Urban Dirt Lab. It's all about the dirt in the urban environment. So when you think about it, when you think about the dirt, the thing that you don't see but affect yourself. Usually think about air pollution. Sometimes you can think about the noise. When it's too noisy, it's affecting yourself also. But there is also the microbial diversity surrounding us. It's, you can find microbes and microorganisms everywhere. They're usually actually very good microorganisms or, you know, fine microorganisms. But at least it's interesting to know what is our environment, at least to prevent better actually potential, you know, contamination if necessary, or to understand more the interactions we have with our environment. So we decided to make a study, and not to make it as scientists would do, meaning that we will make it ourselves, you know, as scientists and study, you know, going around. We decided actually to give the power to the citizen and let the citizen ask themselves what they want to know about their city. So we made an experiment. It was 2 weeks ago, and we handed over special kits for the air pollution that could carry using a collaboration with Prim Labs, a startup. We had an application on the phone to analyze the noise made by an INRIA academic lab, and we distributed microbial sampling kit, so people could sample themselves around. So they will go around the city with little swabs like that, and they will select, you know, areas they want to know what kind of bacteria there is here. And they will bring it back to us, and we analyze the bacteria in order to see, you know, what kind of bacteria. And we can map after that the city with the kind of microbe there is in places that are of special interest to the people, to the citizen. So it was very fun actually to see all those guys actually are non-scientists. They were just random people passing by almost and say, "Oh, that looks cool. I want to know exactly what's on that," you know? And they will do it themselves. So very, very fast forward about what happened to La Paillasse recently. So a year ago, we came to a conclusion that our squat was quite productive, but it was too small. You know, we made a proof of concept that such space are very creative and very productive, and probably could become like a seed for an alternative to academic labs, where you have, you know, you erase the barrier between disciplines and the barriers between social classes. You don't have anymore to be a PhD to access a lab. Labs shouldn't be a privilege to access. It should be a place for everybody to access, for them to think together and think about the future together. So thanks to the mayor of Paris, the city of Paris, we made a huge move. We came from our little squat to right in the center of Paris. So we came from this to this. So it's quite a huge transformation. So that's basically how La Paillasse is organized. So we have, of course, biotech labs, we have fab labs, and we are getting over other kind of sciences. So that's a new space, for example. The kind of views you can have with the biological lab. Here we had a fair around augmented tissues and fabrics. Here is a drone lab. So there are people crazy about drones and manufacturing their own drones in open source. So La Paillasse has made a huge shift. And now it's thinking about how to extend that kind of concept from one area, which is biology, to other sciences and technology. Because at the end, what matters is the diversity. What matters is bringing people that are very different together and then think about how to create new interfaces. So for that, you have to increase and manage that kind of diversity. So we incorporated other areas. So we started with biology, but now we are getting to more the environment, like the agriculture, or the brain, you know, human-computer interfaces. We have also in artificial intelligence lab. We have a lot of applications around health and study. We are making now partnerships with pharmaceutical company to think about how the community and the people can think together about their own health. And of course, the ocean. Ocean is so important. And I can announce that we are now working on a new Paillasse. It's going to be called La Paillasse Ocean, and it will be based on the ocean coast of France, and it will be dedicated for ocean exploration. Think about it. The ocean is an unknown area, so if you want to work, you know, using hacking, and if you want to know more about ocean, we have to work it all together. There are so many things to discover and to use from the ocean. So we have to be more numerous. We have to democratize again the ocean. And biohacker spaces, community labs, actually a very powerful tool to do that. So that's a new project we're doing. And finally, space. Imagine what could be a space program, a community space program, completely open, where everybody is working together about how to make space more cheap and easy to access. So that's some few of the projects we're working on. And to finish, those little points are basically where La Paillasse has made either Paillasses or friends. So La Paillasse now is a network of labs. And we started in Paris, but now we also have a Paillasse in Lyon in France, in Saint-Brieuc in Brittany. We also have one in Ireland in Cork, and also one in the Maker Revolution. So I'll finish on this, and I'll let you actually come to this and think about how you could become yourself biohackers. Thank you very much.
All right, just take a seat. So thanks, Thomas. Now we are going to welcome all our panelists, Tito, Lucas, Yingrui. Thanks for everyone for your presentations. Great inspirations. I think we are going to start today. This is the second time we are doing the biohacking panels for Maker Faire. One is to spark interest, and the other one is to try to start in the dialogue. Last year we had the Doris from the Giga Science to join us, and this year, because of all the interest, we have Yingrui from BGI, and I think we are going to do discussion on two things. First is what's the biohacker space look at organization like BGI? What could they do to help, to speed this up, to facilitate this?
So I think this is a question for BGI, or is it more question for...
This is question for the biospace. Yeah. Is the, when you look at organization like BGI, is asking about what can they do to speed this up?
I can try to give an answer for that. When you think about biohacker space, it's all about democratizing access to resources. So we democratize access to lab equipments. We democratize access to human skills used through the community. And usually what is the limiting factor is what kind of facilities, what kind of resources you can access. So collaborations with organizations like BGIs will enable actually a larger group of people interested, for example, by human health and human genomics to access new kind of resources and maybe launch new kind of programs. So that's where I see the things, the most interesting things to happen.
There's another aspect I personally don't know so much of, but what I don't see so far happening in biohacker space is work with big biodata. And you have a lot of data, bioinformation, that is not very accessible, at least not in Europe. If you talk about the big silos that are also there, that contain a lot of sequenced information and its annotation, that might be very interesting for biohackers also to work with.
So.
Oh, here you go.
Yeah. So, so one of the, I think one of the problem currently when the makers and biohackers trying to work with bigger organizations like BGI. Is a problem of all the different types of communications. It's not just communication between human to human. It's also communication between computer to computer. So one key question currently that the BGI is trying to address is trying to set up a relatively standardized protocols or APIs. That different collaborators from worldwide could really access that they can actually operate on. This is actually very, very hard effort, because we have to think about all the possible to our best effort, all the possible applications that how people will use the data. So this is actually very difficult. And now, as you see, this the biological data is going, booming fast, and all the data flow currently are most of the data shipping are done not by internet, are done by courier service. so in this type of background, and I think it's also not just from the biological space that we. Think about ways and policies and communities, how we can work together. It's also we need help from other industry really actually facilitate all the biotech space. So that's my opinion on that. So the way we are doing now, still you have to, for example, you have to come to our shoe factory to do something, or that we need to go to your space, trying to learn, collide, to make some new ideas. But this is not. I think this is not the right way to do that. And in the future, I think the all things could be much improved. So.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge is physical. Before I was part of Bio-Curious, I actually tried to learn how to do biotechnology on YouTube, and it doesn't work. You can't watch a video of how to do an experiment and really have those sparks. One thing that happened recently is BGI actually came to Bio-Curious in Sunnyvale, and we gave them a tour and we showed them around. And I think that's really the solves that physical solution, because what happens at Bio-Curious in La Paillasse is this smile of discovery. This when your heart beats a little bit faster and you're like, wow, we just figured something new out. And I think that happens physically. And so the more we can do, people come from BGI or people from Bio-Curious and La Paillasse visit, I think that physical being together is something that can really speed things up.
So I think the next step is what's your recommendation? I mean, this year we are getting serious, really going to do it. You have been to Shenzhen, you have been here for a couple of days. How would you start in, I mean, who would you recruit as the community member for biohacker space?
sorry, I would say there is no restriction on that. The community of La Paillasse, we don't decide on which is part of the community. It's any motivated person or curious person can join in. So our doors are completely open. But usually what we see, so we have a lot of students. We also have quite numerous amount of people that have already a job, but want to spare, to use their spare time and share their skills. We also have a lot of entrepreneurs, people that have more free times and are looking for opportunities. And then we also have retired people that have a lot of free time too and a lot of experience, and that are usually looking for and just understanding their new world. So at the end, probably to have a primer, I would say, with a small community, either of makers and students that have more time and very motivated, and to create a whirlpool and to attract others. But creating community is already the hardest part. Creating a lab, you know, putting equipment inside, that's the easiest part of it. But creating a community, creating a dynamic, maintaining the community, that's the hardest part of the job, the most interesting one also. But that's where all your focus should be. It's all about letting people creating their own opportunities.
At the Civic Center, we had a booth of the Open Wetlab, and the times I was there, I had a lot of great, energetic conversations with very young people, with parents that were translating for their children, or children that were translating for their parents, what we did and what... There was a guy of, I think, 14, spoke well English. He wasn't satisfied with my explanation of how a PCR worked, because he wanted to know what happens after, because the PCR reaction is only one step in the whole protocol. There's a lot of energy here, and a lot of creativity, and a lot of eagerness to get involved in this. I don't know, we also know in Amsterdam that building this community takes a long breath. You need to be open, you need to be open in the evening, you need to talk to a lot of people that come for one time, come maybe for a second time, then they're gone. You have to really engage in that community. I don't know how that will happen here, but I felt more interest for what we did by the people that were talking with me at my booth than I would feel in Amsterdam. So that is a very good starting point. But again, like I also said in my presentation, I also encountered, there was also quite a few people that asked me, but what do you make? Do you bring something to the market? I also said, we organize workshops that you can join us with, and you pay a little bit for that. I said something about the other things. We don't bring so much from the Open Wetlab to the market. And I think it's not only about that, about a maker scene, a creator scene, a learning scene to bring stuff to the market or to invent things as quick as possible and bring them to the market. There's also a difference between what we do in a Wetlab and what is done in, for instance, a Fab Lab. In the Fab Lab, you create objects and machines to make new machines. In a wet lab, you create machines to make more experiment or to make more efficient experiment, to make more understanding. However, I think also what Thomas explained there is a lot of playful things that you can do in new materials development. We work with people that make fungi, that grow fungi, in order to understand whether you can also alter fungi to make beer with it in a bioreactor. Beer comes from a bioreactor. But they also try to grow fungi in order to investigate whether you can use it for construction materials or packaging materials. That is also very close to creativity. So I think there's a lot of energy here. I think what such a maker fair here does is fantastic. But I would love to see more creativity in there, more artistic questioning of what is the politics behind the production of new matter. I think that enriches a community in your lab also very much.
Great. So getting artists involved is, we have been thinking about this both for electronics. It's what that thinks. Being produced means, and I guess it's also very important for the biohacking. Any word, Tito, about people, community building?
Yeah, sure. So growing up, I always heard this phrase, talk is cheap. And it means that talking is sort of seen as this thing, like, well, you should go out and actually do something. But now, when I reflect on that phrase kind of as an entrepreneur, I see it in a different light. I say, talk is cheap. That means it's very low cost. It's very easy to do. We can talk all day, and it doesn't cost a lot of money. The first year of Bio-Curious, we just got together for lectures, we had discussions, and I think the value of that is that we can actually get together and talk, and start to learn together. We would have lectures and then panels like this. I think that's a very important part, is where people ask questions. And so I think that would be the next step, is to focus on talking, because that's what can help all of us put us more on a level playing field with biotech. Whereas, I mean, otherwise, if we put somebody from BGI in a room with somebody who knows electronics, their actual skills are completely different. But if we're just talking, then we're more equal. We can just share ideas. And I think that was the foundation of Bio-Curious. That's a lot what I've loved about La Paillasse, is they ask these amazing questions. And I think that if you can turn that phrase around, talk is cheap, and look at talking as one of the most valuable assets that you have.
Great. So we are going to open the question up for the audience. Anyone?
Hey, thanks, panel. My question is for all of you guys: how to get people interested in DLA bio for, you know, layperson? Because I have traveled to attract people here in Shenzhen, you know, try to grow a community together. So yeah, thanks.
It's all about traction. what Tito said is completely true. Talking is cheap, but it's what makes actually it useful. And you create events. Inviting people, it takes time. You have, you know, a stepping curve. And so the first few steps, you're not going to be few improvement, or you'll see like a huge traction the first time because it's exciting, but then the hardest part will come, because then you will have to get people more fidel to your motives. So at the end, it's, I think, the best way to do it is explain to people that what you've created, it's for them to use freely. And you don't have to explain them how to do it. So, you know, I believe in your potential, I believe in your creativity, I believe in you doing actually interesting things. Just use that. And think about what you can do next. You know, it could be like a bridge for something new for you. So at the end, it's all about exploration. Exploration about new ways, new spaces, about you also. So at the end, yeah, it's you know, you're democratizing actually expression through science and technology, and I'm sure you will find a lot of people, especially in Shenzhen, where you have this strong maker culture, so they are already sensibilized to this aspect, and just explaining why biology is important is something I would say easy, because it's already a concept that we have in mind when you think about it, about, you know, the environment, about renewables, about producing materials. You don't have to explain many things for them to catch the key phrases, the key concepts. And then when they understand that, you let them express, you know, you don't have to tell them what to do. Just make it happen. It's like creating a cocoon, if you want, where people feel well.
I have a specific example, which is by these things called miracle berries. I think they grow, it's a little red berry that when you eat it, it changes your tongue so that things that are sour, like a lemon, taste very sweet. And that's just that's an amazing way to get people interested in biology, biotechnology, proteins, all that stuff, is just to say like, hey, have you read Harry Potter? With those jelly beans that change flavors and all sorts of stuff, like, come experience that. People can understand that. People want to do that. And it's sort of a way to say, hey, did you know that this is how it works? It happens later. And so miracle berries, I think the value of that is that you can get people together to try that. That was one of our first experiments when we were in a garage, was eating miracle berries and eating lemon, and it tastes sweet. It's like, what? And then you eat anything sour becomes like the sweetest thing you've ever eaten. And it's amazing. So get together and eat some miracle berries.
Just before I came to the space, we had a very brief talk on the corridor. You mentioned the kitchen. You eat fermented foods here in China. You eat a lot of mushrooms. we had some very nice experiences around creating events and hands-on collaborations with people that had to do with food and food production. So working with fungi, mycelium, brewing your own beer, working with yeasts that you can find everywhere and that are very local. If you know that kimchi in Korea differs from town to town because the yeasts differ from town to town, that is very interesting knowledge. So there is a lot of common knowledge under you, the people, about using microorganisms to for food production. And that is a very interesting and nice and point of entry into how that biologically works. And in fact, it's a technology.
Thank you very much for very interesting talks. And it may not apply to the guys in Shenzhen, but I'm from Japan. Have you faced with some kind of risk or that kind of questions? Is there any danger involved from the public that if you let guys, just laymen, to deal with the DNAs or bacteria and stuff like that? Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. Even in the United States, it's very different. I want to ask how much time we have, because I know there's one, two questions, but I just wanted to see. Okay, great. Yeah, I mean, so one of the things that makes software so easy to work with is that you really can't blow up your computer. No matter what you do with software, you can always just undo it. And so one of the things we've done at Bio-Curious is to make that type of experience, to make it, it's called a biosafety level one lab in the United States, which means it's comparable to what you would find in a high school. So that means that nothing there is dangerous, nothing's pathogenic, and what that means is people can experiment with things without any danger. We also have a safety group that reviews projects just to make sure that it fits into the BSL-1 framework. But the idea is, the value of that is really to create this sandbox where you can try anything.
We just got a permit to work with low pathogen organisms and GMOs. Only one construct, because the whole law around that in Europe differs from that in the United States. We have our own certified biosafety officer that works with us when we have questions or when we have events that involve such risks. But you also must realize that a lot of this, the thoughts around these sorts of risks are also based on emotions and pre-assumptions, because what you have in your kitchen sink is often more harmful. If you take a bucket of water from a canal outside and you culture the bacteria therein, or you drink it, you might get more poisoned than working in that lab. You use alcohol a lot. And so we have a monthly biosafety course. We teach people also about those pre-assumptions, but also to work safe. And it's also part of the fun. To come in and to have to do that course, because people learn from that, and it's also fun to understand what is really risky and what is not, and what you thought was very risky and in fact is not.
And at the end, it's even if you remove, if you concentrate, focus on all non-pathogenic organism. Yeah, there is so much fun and interesting things to do. So exactly as Tito said, it's a BSL-1 lab is at the level of a kitchen in which you actually control the kind of organism you're working with. So it's even safer. So the simplest rule is actually when you welcome project, it's what we do also at Apias, and I guess everybody's doing that. Just ask people about what they want to do, and you ask yourself and you with the committee if this is be inside the realm of the law. So it's very simple. So you, and everything is transparent at the end. So if you have any risk, you know, it's monitored somehow by the community. So because people talk to each other, they ask questions, and if something, you know, has to be raised as an alarm, that, oh, that could be dangerous, then it's, everybody knows it very fast because everybody talks, because it's, you know, it's open.
If I can briefly add something to that, it's also interesting to realize that there's much more unsafe things or much more dangerous things happening in academic or commercial labs. Of course, there's also a lot of safety regulations in there, but why are we as biohack spaces not allowed to do those? If you do it under in safe circumstances, etc., it's also something of a question about the democratization of that technology, if you ask me. So we also try to provoke the government a little bit in giving us such a permission. So we have a lot of conversation about that in order to alter that. If you can work safe and you can prove that, why not grant us the same rights as other labs?
I think we have time for one more question.
Go. Raising his hands.
There's a lady in the back there.
All right. Yes.
Oh. Maybe we could just say all the questions. It looks like there's a lot of questions.
Hello. Thank you for giving the great presentation. One question really bothered me for a long time. You know, human being right now, nowadays, maybe millions of years ago or something, and we are not human, right? Maybe it's a monkey, something like that. So through the evolution today, we are so different between animal, Adam, and other species. So my question is, what about the human being going to is any other evolution? Through the evolution, what kind of would be hypergenic, one part of human being, one part of emotion, or totally different that you can in operate your IQ maybe 205 or 300 or something like that. So what will be in the human species, human being in the future, maybe 100 years later or 200 years later? Thank you.
Okay, so if I understand well, so you're asking about transhumanism and the improvement of human beings, right? That's a hard question because not only a technical question but also ethical question. And in La Paillasse, we don't express, especially attack that kind of questions, because it's a realm that is somehow very sensible. You see, it's a we prefer actually just say that if you want to work on humans directly, you have to do that something because it's so hard to control, you know, what people are doing. Most people in transhumanism somehow are artists. It's like artist performances. So it's not very well controllable. So we better not enter that kind of realm. So I don't know if you want to answer that kind of question.
You can come and work at a biohack space and try to answer such a question by sharing your research there and try to get in a conversation with people working at such labs and see whether there is an interest to share thoughts about that. One of the first projects that was awarded the Bio Art and Design Award was specifically about this question, about making bulletproof skin. I can show you the link. Maybe it's too. We don't have enough time to go really deep into that project. But again, I can send you the link, then you have another sort of thought about that. But I share with Thomas that it's really far out, but it's an important question if you think about designer babies.
It's the discussion and the debate is completely open, so we actually have discussion about that also. But to make a project on that specifically, we don't allow it in APA because there is too much risk. But you know, because you're touching human materials, and that belongs not to BSL-1, but at least BSL-2. Yeah. And so in terms of legislation, you cannot do that easily.
So,
sure. Yeah. So actually, well, I think from the human evolutionary view, many of the preset assumptions on how humans should really evolve is actually wrong. One classical example. So when we talk about the evolution means the change in all the allele frequencies in the human, which is the variant frequencies in human. As long as the variant is constantly changing, that means evolution. So one of the classical example of how evolution goes wrong in our current mindset is all those obesity type diabetes or hypertension type of variants. For most of the years that our human Homo sapiens are living on Earth, that it will be a fantastic selection advantage that if you eat something, you absorb as much as possible and store them in your fat cell. Because for most of the human history, that we are, it's very easy that for us to be in a hungry mode. Because of the limited production, so that's actually advantages to have the susceptibility to be obesity. But nowadays, because of that, we have so much productions of food of whatever type of things. This becomes a problem in the current modern society, and we see a lot of the increase in the prevalence of all the different metabolic syndromes. So. If you are a scientist back to 100 years ago and you have all these tools, you probably would engineer people. You're steering the people to have more fat on their body. But if you are a scientist now, you probably want to change in another totally different direction. So it would be very hard for human ourselves to judge that where we should go. And we typically we still leave it for the nature model in a way that because things actually goes for myself actually I have a small pet project that with me I would like to really to store my all my DNA information and all type of things within the yeast and store all the how they organize together and to in the East community, so that at some days, probably people in a thousand years after, they could use all those type of information and to reconstruct me. That's actually a successful, come on, that's actually a definition, by definition, that's a successful creature.
Oh, that's an art project.
Yeah.
All right. Do we still have time?
One more question.
I'm
just going to reflect one more thing. I think it's interesting, but we should probably better focus on repairing than augmenting. You know, before augmenting, you know, let's try at least to repair all the defects that humans can have, especially through that we can have through accidents or genetic diseases. And we are clearly not there yet. Then if we have repaired everything, or can repair everything, then we can think about augmenting.
Can you state your question, and then she'll state her question, and then we do the thing where we like kind of answer both? Is that okay?
Sure. Someone has a question in the back?
Yeah. We can gather maybe three questions at the same time. And
Hi. Thanks for the wonderful talk. I just came in halfway. I'm sorry. I'm Cindy, and I'm also part of this loose collective of people called DIY Bio in Singapore. And I think one question I really want to ask is, I think most of you have mentioned like how you can teach biology simply through fermentation or like through mycelium, fungi, and reproducing things out of that. I think a big problem I face is because I always go to Indonesia for research, and they also have their own DIY bio groups as well. And most of the time, the workshop participants, and I guess because most of them are from the global south, will probably be asking me, like, why do they have to do fermentation, or why do they have to, like, reproduce mycelium to create furniture or some other things, because they've been doing this for ages. How is that science for them? And if they want to do something slightly more high-tech, like synthetic biology, they have a problem with accessibility of equipment and sustainability of the lab itself. And second question is the fun question, is anybody doing Soylent research now? Soylent. Soylent? Yeah. Soylent? Soylent. The sort of male replacement synthetic, yeah. Just a fast question, yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Oh, I had a very pragmatic question. Thank you, this was really lovely. But I would love to hear more about, you guys mentioned that there's already some partnership and collaboration happening between BGI and Bio-Curious, and I would just love to hear more about how that's playing out in practice right now and what's going on there.
Maybe a third question, and
that was three. She had two.
Oh yeah, but three people, let's say. Maybe. Okay.
To answer your question about the gap between the fermentation and mycelium growing, yes, that gap is there. But we also facilitate people that want to go further into. Doing real research. We're not an academic lab, so we don't do academic research as such. But for instance, also via this BioArt and Design Award, we have a large network of high-end labs that work with stem cell technology, with toxicology, a wide range of biosciences out there. So that also makes that if people have more complex questions to research, we can send them there, and often there is a scientific community that is happy to welcome them.
Your question about access to lab equipment, for example. So we started a community in Philippines, close to Manila, and they came close to the same problem, saying that they have people, they have ideas, or they want to do stuff, but they have limited access to equipment. Because it's more difficult than in Europe or in North America to access to all pieces of lab equipment that laboratory would throw away. So that's also part of the answer for why there is so many biohacker spaces in Occidental countries and not that much where it could be so much useful, in more developing countries. And the part of the answer is because it's a question of resources again. All those lab equipment that you can recycle, they're there already. There are so many labs, public or private labs, and they get rid of lab equipment like that. You know, they are like consumerists like us. It's amazing the amount of lab equipment they can throw away. You know, in a matter of a few weeks, we could gather enough lab equipment for making one complete lab. So it was just using three different lab sources. So right now in with La Paillasse, we are organizing somehow a lab anti-king campaign so that we are contacting many labs around at least France for now, and we tell them that we need that kind of resources so that we can centralize all that and if needed, send over even overseas those kind of lab equipment and share this with all the communities. And that could boost, literally, the creation of biohacker spaces around the world. And so that's what we're trying to do for Philippines. Probably we could do it also for Singapore.
And the other question was about BGI and Bio-Curious, or how to collaborate between the tiniest lab in the world and the largest lab in the world. And I think it was more of a first date, so they came to our lab and we showed them around and talked about what we were up to. The value of that is it's very easy to do. It's easy to bring people in and talk.
I think I could answer both questions in your answer. So again, actually back to my earlier slide, said there is a part on my slide that called that there's omics and medical centers. So I think if we look at the history of computers, at some stage there people start to build those so-called supercomputers that is very similar to the resources or the scalable economy resources that BGI is trying to build in the genomics field. And we also need those small personal
computer type of desktop instruments that is actually connect to the whole infrastructure of in the biotech field. Again, the problem now is we haven't set the biology in a way that is very marginalized. So it's very hard for us to really easily exchange all the resources. And there's a lot of other regulatory crazy stuff there. But I think in the long run, as long as we have the idea, just like in the computer science, we have the cloud computing. And it's very likely that in someday, the, all the resources can be exchanged and accessed via a similar concept, like cloud sequencing or cloud whatever biotechnology. So that's a, one of my my thoughts.
Yeah. Anyone wants to answer? Anyone have the answer to any of those questions? Or well, we are really running over the time.
It was more related to BioCurious and BGI, but I would say that we don't have yet a relationship with BGI. We do, so, however, have relationship with other large groups, like Roche, for example. And I have to say that exactly to, I will repeat myself for a bit, but those kind of large groups, they have amazing resources that they can share. And because we can also share the same goals sometimes, it means that we can mutualize those kind of resources and work together. So I believe that that's part of the future where, you know, industries, corporations, startups, academic groups, amateurs, hackerspace, they will all collaborate with each other, because at the end it's all about solving problems, you know, that have common problems.
Well, I think we are, what, 15 minutes over time, but talk is cheap and we can do this forever. But it's really great for everyone to come over these times. And hopefully we'll see you guys soon again. And hopefully by then, we actually have a biohacker space here in Shenzhen. And again, thanks to all the panelists.
Yeah. Thank you.